Okay, so welcome everybody to this historic event, historic in physical science, also the first seminar being run by the brand new Early Career and Postgraduate Research Network on the eSocSci platform. So it augurs very well for the future of this fantastic initiative. So you've all seen the blurb and advertising for this seminar, which is going to be focusing on becoming an academic writer, a lifelong project of becoming, I must say. And so the focus is going to be on the tricks and the techniques that our very experienced panel use to pursue their own careers, I guess, and their own project of becoming as writers. So what we're going to be, how we're going to run this is I'm going to briefly introduce the three panelists, and then they are each going to have 3 to 5 minutes to respond to a question that I will pose to them, which actually they've given to me to pose to them. I think they're wanting to, they've fed it all to me. I'm not responsible for anything. And then there's going to be a little writing exercise. So I hope you've all got a pen and paper. I think that's the plan. Mm-hmm. And then there's going to be a second question that I post to the panel they will all respond to, and then a chance for questions and discussions. Okay, so that's the plan. So I'll just introduce everybody quickly. We have three fabulous associate professors and very experienced writers. Sitting at her desktop at home is Barbara Grant, who's worked at various permutations of the University of Auckland's Academic Development Unit. I wouldn't like to go through the names of all the different things that's been called over her career. But, and it's now located in the University School of Critical Studies and Education and the Education Faculty. Barbara, you will have read the blurbs probably, but you know she has run writing retreats for 20 plus years now. In fact, I think, and honestly, that maybe Barbara invented the writing retreat, and has been hugely influential in the kind of, what is the word, the proliferation of writing retreats as a model across our country and in other countries too overseas. She's also written a facilitation guide for writing retreats, and as she says in her blurb also, she's recently spent a few years as the executive editor of HERD, the HERD journal, reading many, many hundreds of manuscripts, I'm sure, of very varied quality, and as she also says, often mourning the lack of a good first sentence. I'm trying to get my undergraduates. Okay, so welcome, Barbara.
Thanks.
So we also have Clinton Golding from the University of Otago, who's also in the era, or, you know, is still, he's waving. You can see him waving there. He works in the academic development field as a very prolific writer, but as he says, he also teaches about writing, reads about writing, writes about writing, and thinks about writing, and I think maybe possibly also dreams about writing. It's quite a nice thing to do. And as Clinton also said, he's learning the art of reading like a writer and writing like a reader, which sounds really nice, I thought. And last but definitely not least, also down at Otago, sitting next to Clinton, we have Karen Nen, who's in the College of Education at Otago, and I think I could safely describe you, Karen, as a feminist geographer. I hope that's correct. And Karen is currently teaching a new postgraduate course on writing for publication in the social sciences, which I'm sure is attracting a lot of enrolments down there, and I'm sure everybody wishes they had one in their department as well. As she also says, she's published about demystifying academic writing and her writing group's mutiny, which sounds very intriguing. Maybe we'll hear more about that as we go through the session. So, yeah, welcome the three of you. And, okay, so I'm just going to go straight into posing the first question. I'm not sure who's going in what order, but maybe you figure that out between you. But the first question for you each to respond to is, who are you as a writer? Who are you? Who's going to go first?
Okay, I will. I'll boldly step forth. So we put these questions together, as Averill said, and then I realised that it was actually quite a difficult question as I sort of sat down to ponder. But I love thinking of myself as a writer, and it still kind of seems like a novel identity even after two decades. Like, I thought it was as an identity that described creative writers, which is really interesting that I'm already distinguishing between creative and academic writing, because in fact academic writing is a creative process. But nevertheless, here I am on a panel and on how we become academic writers, which is really good to kind of be thinking about this and putting it centre stage. And I'll always see myself as always in the process. I mean, as you said, Aotearoa, a lifelong project. And I actually, really make the most of opportunities like this to think about, to think and talk and write about being a writer. Like, I actually sort of wrote about this in my preparation for the session. And I think the more times we have for kind of claiming the identity of writing and rehearsing the identity of writer, that, it's part of our own process of taking ourselves seriously as writers, which I think is really important. But I do think it's a complicated identity. Like, our lives, our kind of working lives depend on writing and publishing, and yet that pressure sometimes can feel counterproductive to the process of writing. And yet, on the other hand, I'm delighted that there's, that it's part of my job description. I was a high school teacher before becoming an academic, and I love the fact that in my kind of this job, I'm expected to write. So in my process of becoming an academic writer, I do see it as one that where I've sort of just tried to work away gradually at kind of taking up more space and thinking about myself as a writer, of referring to myself as a writer, and even talking about my writing, like what project I'm involved in at the moment. And actually, the whole process of even offering the course, writing for publication, was all that sort of gradual, part of that gradual process of kind of taking up more space and thinking about me as a writer. So I see myself as a persistent, plodding writer, which is probably not, plodding is probably not the sort of most glamorous title or thing to describe yourself, but nevertheless, I see it as persistence, particularly as the defining qualities of my writing career to date. And this is where there's kind of a connection between kind of yoga and writing. There's this great piece about kind of why yoga and writing are similar. Basically, the yoga sort of piece is saying that we have to just keep on turning up on the mat. And in writing, that's, I keep on turning up in front of the computer, even if I don't feel like, I'm in the writing zone, whatever that might be. So I just see that as a fundamental aspect of my writing, is turning up in front of the computer. And even when I don't sort of feel the muse is with me or not. So, and I'm also a writer who enjoys writing with others. So, for example, I wrote The Children of Rogenomics with Jane Higgins and Judith Sligo. And one of the things about writing with Jane Higgins is that in that year that we wrote the book Children of Rogenomics, she also published her first novel for young adults. And it was great. Whenever you work with someone, you've got kind of a front row seat on someone else's writing process. And so that was a fantastic kind of moment to see how, like, I often am happy to get the first draft together, and then to watch Jane's crafting of my draft was a delight. But to see how she did that, how she loved that, actually gave me a new sort of appreciation of crafting writing. So that's and probably the other part of that is we often imagine kind of writing as a solitary occupation, and one of the key insights from an early workshop that I facilitated was I had asked people to bring a piece of academic writing they loved and adored, and we looked at it as to how it was constructed. And one of the first things that people talked about was that they really felt one of the features was that the reader was addressed, often with the engaging first sentence that Barbara is looking for as well. And so that was something that, really thinking about writing for readers. And that's something that, I see as really important. And probably the other thing is that I read widely, both fiction and across disciplines, which all kind of feeds my store of writerly practices and my sense of self as a writer. So that's my opening.
Me next?
Yes.
Yep. Hello everyone, I'm Clinton. I'm going to try to keep it pretty short and sweet. I was trying to figure out who I am as a writer, and I realised I have multiple identities. I don't write all the time. I write some of the time, but I'm also a teacher. I'm also a husband. I'm a carer. I'm a researcher. And so part of my identity as a writer is balancing the multiple identities and often conflicting identities. And I thought this is probably useful to bring up because we all struggle with the time to do this because we have other things that are also part of who we are. But I am a writer that's in there as part of the mix. And part of the process of realizing that I was a writer, one part was firstly realizing that my job was writing. When I was writing a PhD, I was writing a PhD. Doesn't matter how much reading I was doing or lab work, or I'm not a philosopher. I'm not a scientist. I am a philosopher. My work, especially in humanities and social sciences, writing. So I am a writer in that sense. That is what my job is to produce words. But I also transitioned where I realized that writing, my job wasn't just the craft of writing. So you can imagine, my tool is writing and that's how I do my job. But actually writing is my art form. Writing is my form of expression as well. There was a shift from first that I was a philosopher or an educationalist, then I was a writer, and then actually I'm a writer in the sense that an artist is an artist, rather than I'm a writer in the sense that a tradesman uses particular tools. When I was in school, I used to draw and paint and stuff, but it didn't draw me out in the same way that writing does. I'm compelled to write in a way that I wasn't compelled with any other things. And I used to play drums and dance and things like that, but they're mere hobbies. Great, but they're not who I am. So there's something about my mode of expression in the world is writing, which means that the articles and things that I write become a lot more important to me than just something that gets churned out for the sake of it. So I'm a writer in the sense that an artist is an artist. That's me. From Barbara, you're up next.
Yeah, that's me. So I think I had three things to say, really. And I just like there are so many things you could say to this question. But I had three things, and when I look at them, they add up to something that's kind of unfinished about my sense of myself as a writer. It's an unfinished sense. So the first thing I wanted to say is that I think I'm quite an ambivalent writer. I find writing really hard, but I also enjoy it. I love the rush of having an idea of what I might write, but then there's a slog of turning that idea into a piece of writing. And almost always inside every piece that I write, there's a crisis where I think I've got nothing. I think I've done all this work and actually there's nothing, I have nothing to say here. And that crisis sometimes takes quite a lot of courage to get past. That ambivalence means that when I retire, which isn't so far away these days, I'm not sure if I'll write another word. It hurts my body as well as my mind, writing, actually, these days. So yeah, I don't know if I will continue to write, but it's been a big part of my life for a long time. Another aspect of the unfinishedness for me is that I'm a restless writer. I'm nearly always, I think it's true that I'm usually feeling disappointed in myself in terms of the writing I'm not getting to do. I wrestle all the time with how to find time for writing. And that's made even harder for me by struggling to have time to read, which has been particularly bad in the last few years when I was editing the journal, because a lot of my evenings were spent reading manuscripts, not reading stuff that I really want to read, say. So reading feeds my writing, and without reading, I find my voice just dries up. But I'm also literally restless in my body when I write, which is probably a good thing because it means that I move a lot. And so I often use a Pomodoro device, which means that after every 25 minutes, I stand and I do something. I stretch or I do a different kind of task. So there's a kind of restlessness that I associate with writing, which is both energizing but also disturbing. And the third thing I wanted to say about myself as a writer, the third unfinished thing, is that I'm a learning writer. I keep learning more about it. And I've been talking about writing with others and reading about writing for a long, long time now. So I learn a lot from reading the good writing of others, maybe the bad, but that's a much less pleasurable way of learning, I have to say. And I learn from talking about writing with my postgrad students and also the Women Writing Away community that I've been working with now for nearly 20 years. So writing for me is a process of learning, and some of that learning is sort of like relearning things that I've learned and then forgotten. Because there's something kind of quite deep about writing. It's tied to habits. It's tied to slightly obsessive kinds of patterns of practice. It's tied sometimes to doing things that I really don't want to do, but they turn out to be the right thing to do. So I'm a learning writer. And I guess for me, as I say, that adds up to being, for writing, the writer self for me is a very unfinished kind of self. Never going to get finished, I think. That's me.
Fantastic. I can see some nods around the room here. Nods of recognition. Now, somebody, one of you three is going to pose a writing task, I think, at this point.
Yeah, so we thought that having sort of, you know, revealed our inner writers, that we would get you to just actually write about how you see yourselves as writers, wherever you are. So basically the same question, and who are you as a writer? And we've got some spare paper here if anyone would like it.
Put up.
And yeah, so we're, you know, 5 minutes or...
Okay, Karen, are you going to time?
Or do you think slightly less, like 3 minutes? April, I'll leave it up to you.
Barbara, you're the expert on these exercises. 5 sounds good to me, but do you think 3?
I think 5 sounds good. Let's just go for it for 5. Blasting down words, phrases, sentences, whatever
works. Melanie's going to keep a tab on time for us. Okay.
Great.
Off you go.
So the question was, who are you as a writer?
Thank you.
try.
Okay, that was 5 minutes. Amazing how fast it goes, isn't it? There's a good little writing strategy right there. Start your question. Dump it on a piece of paper. Okay, so now there's a second question to pose to the panel, and that is how do you cultivate yourself as a writer? So that is, what practices are important? What conditions or forms of self-trickery do you adopt? I like the idea of tricking ourselves into writing. So I don't know if you want to go in the same order or you want to reverse order or...
Let's go for a reverse order. So Barbara,
okay. That's right. Let's make sure I'm unmuted. Right, you can hear me. Okay, so Karen talked at the beginning about the idea that comes from yoga about turning up to the mat, to the mat. I'm a yoga teacher, I'm a yoga practitioner as well. I attend yoga, and for everyone I attend yoga together quite often. And I can vouch for some of the deep similarities between the practices of writing and the practices of yoga. They both take a certain kind of determination to keep going, and they can both feel pretty horrible sometimes when you do them. So I try to make with my writing regular times to turn up to the writing. And over the many years I've been an academic, I've made heaps and heaps of different plans to do this. At the end of the writing retreats, we always have a round where we talk about our plans for how to keep the writing going for the next 6 months. And I always have ideas, and sometimes they work and sometimes they don't. In my experience, the most successful things that have worked for me have sometimes been quite simple, like using the Pomodoro. So here's the Pomodoro. It's a little kitchen tomato. There's a 40-page manual on the interweb that you can get to tell you how to use this technique, but actually you can figure it out in like half a minute. It's a really good way of teasing in writing. Basically, it's a 25-minute timer. So a writing unit is 25 minutes. And it's a really good way of squeezing in writing into a busy day, because most of us can find 25 minutes. It's the longer bits of time that are really elusive. This year's plan that I thought of over the summer is to turn up to an empty room. It's a lovely room. It's got a view, as it happens, of Auckland Harbour. It's a room that's actually booked on a standing basis by some other people. It's on another campus. It's a campus I travel through between getting off the boat and getting to my own campus. And I'm going to go there for the same day each week for the same 2.5 hours and be in that room where nobody knows me and I'm mostly alone so far. Once there's been someone with me, but otherwise I've been alone. So I've been doing that now for a whole 3 weeks and it's working like a charm. So I'm hoping that that's going to be my practice for this year. It just seems to be the right year to do this kind of practice. So that gives me a weekly practice of 2.5 hours of writing. So really that's just taking my laptop and my notes and writing, as opposed to being at home in my office where it's easy to get distracted with lots of other things. Alongside that practice, I organise and I nearly always attend 2 residential writing retreats for academic women down at the Tohara Retreat Centre at Taupo. Now, I've been doing this for 20 years, and the thing that motivated me most to do it really was the fact that my best friend left the university and went off to another university, and I was trying to figure out ways that we could get together. So we did. Avril and 5 other people and I turned up at this centre 20 years ago, and we've been turning up there about twice a year ever since. And it's become a big network of academic women from all over New Zealand and a few from Australia and from Canada who come back to this place regularly. And although I organise it and I do some kind of facilitation, over the years I've done less facilitation, and I actually have always participated in those writing retreats as a writer. That week is like a saving grace for me. Often if I'm feeling panicky about something that I'm not going to get finished, I can kind of think I've got that week coming up. And sometimes I finish a couple of things in that week, sometimes I only start one thing. And sometimes that week can be quite a hard week, actually, for writing. So it's not like it's always easy, but it is always regular time, and it's sociable time. I get friendship from other academic women who have lives like mine, pretty much, and I get companionship and stimulation for the craft of writing, and I've learned heaps from writing, as I've already said. For several years now, I facilitated a doctoral writing group with my school. It's a hard thing to fit into my calendar often, but I keep remembering that it's another sign that I have a writing life. Although I'm the facilitator, I also participate, so I put my own writing up for feedback, just as they do. And if we have activities, which I often prepare, I participate just as they do. So I try always to occupy this double position of writer as well as writing teacher. The other thing I do, which is part of the enjoyment of writing, is I often give myself permission to spend a couple of hours to really craft some aspect of my writing. I have the thesaurus to hand. I will use all the strategies I've learned. So I might really work over the title of a piece or the first sentence or a particular paragraph. I mean, if I was a poet, I would do this for every word in my poems. But academic writers, well, the rhythm of academic writing, as Clinton points out, it's harried because it's fitted in around the other roles that we occupy in our academic lives. And so actually wordsmithing is a luxury for academics, but it's a luxury I try to take regularly with my writing, because it's so that is the pleasurable stuff in writing for me. And the last thing I do is I try to expose myself to good writing, academic and non-academic, and I'm more and more interested as I get become an older academic writer in the boundary and losing the hard boundary between those two forms. So I'm quite interested in writing of the kind that's called ficto-criticism or factivism, or there's a range of titles for writing that sits on the kind of cusp between fiction and non-fiction writing, and I'm becoming more and more interested in that as a way to write as an academic writer. So I'm trying to practice some of that. It doesn't come easily, I must say. So that's me, the kinds of things I have found that I'm still doing, that are part of my ongoing cultivation of myself as a writer. Clinton.
Thank you. I do a lot of the same stuff that Barbara does, so I don't want to go over the same ground. One of the things that made a difference in me being able to cultivate myself was swapping from writing, thinking that it had to be this perfect thing that I produced, to realising that what you produce first can be rubbish, and then you can slowly hone it. That realisation occurred over many years, but it freed me up from a lot of procrastination and feeling bad about my writing. This is not to say that it's not hard, it's still extraordinarily hard, but I realised it's okay to write rubbish. That's quite freeing. And building on that, I use a lot of techniques to write in non-intimidating forms. So my initial writing is often with felt tip pens. It's very hard to feel like you have to be perfect when you're writing in felt-tip pens. Or I wear it on a whiteboard, or I put it on big pieces of paper and I put diagrams and stuff like that. And I deliberately, my first step of my writing is always I take off any requirement that it has to be spelled well or grammatical or even makes any sense to anybody but myself. So the first stage is always non-intimidating, it's just get some stuff on the page, on the whiteboard, or whatever I happen to be writing on. So I'm writing in a little notebook now, and I just found a notebook quite handy. It's less intimidating than an A4 sheet. I don't feel like it should be, it is finished. And I started writing a blog a couple of weeks before this workshop, and I'm finding that a less intimidating one as well. I don't feel like I have to have it as polished as I would to send off stuff in an academic sense. So, just non-intimidating ways that free me up. The other thing that seems to help me a lot is I set myself up to be accountable for my writing. For me, that it was often being a writing teacher. If I'm going to teach writing, I better be writing. I can't, or for example, taking up Karen's invite to do a writing workshop like this, that really did motivate me to get onto the blog and make sure I'd produce some work. And it's like, oh, crikey, I haven't finished any articles for a while and my teaching has been getting out of control. Okay, let's get some writing done. So I've set myself up, and many of us in academia are teachers. I'm a teacher as well. So teaching something both helps me to understand it, but it also helps me to be accountable to produce it. I used to run a writing group. My colleague Rob, who you can't see in the corner there, runs it now. That I felt accountable for producing writing. I couldn't keep a writing group going if I wasn't writing. So Those sorts of things helped me a lot. But the other thing that I do a lot that helps to cultivate me is my writing and my thinking are not distinct. They are the same thing. I coined a term this morning. I was doing a workshop on this in zoology, and I think write a lot. My writing is my thinking. I don't think first and then I write about it. My writing is my thinking. I solve problems in my everyday life by writing about them. I clarify my thoughts by writing about them. I often don't know what I think until I write it down. So over time, I've slowly just given myself over to that my writing is my thinking. They're not separate activities. I don't get my thinking clear and then write. I write think, or I think write. I don't know which way that goes. One other thing that seemed to help me a lot is I had to shift at a certain point in my writing from thinking, I know what I'm doing and this is really clear, to I wonder how the readers take this. I was a fairly arrogant writer, and I was a terrible writer because of it, because I didn't consider, I know what I mean. This is great stuff. But it just wasn't landing for my readers at all. So, and that's what I meant by writing like a reader. I've deliberately cultivated myself to try to write, not thinking what I mean, but thinking, well, how will this land for a reader? What did I actually write, rather than what do I think I mean? Now, I do that in two stages. When I'm first writing, I'm just worrying about what I mean, but then I rewrite it for how will this land for a reader. I try to write it thinking from a reader's perspective rather than thinking from my own perspective. And I had to learn to read my writing rather than read what I think I meant. And they're very, very different. Often we only see what we meant rather than what we actually wrote. And that's still hard, and it still takes me a long time to try and get through that. And the other thing that I do a lot now is I practice my writing. And there's lots and lots and lots of great guidebooks about good writing. And I just practice an exercise. And it might be one page from it, and I'll rewrite an entire article based on that page to try to practice it. And then I'll do another one until that starts to become second nature to me. There's still a lot more to learn. I'm not by no means a great writer, but that process of practicing seems to help a lot. So use that feedback from others. I can take somebody's feedback and see how my writing actually lands and improve it, and then I might practice an exercise. The last thing that I'm starting to do now is I'm practicing more spontaneous writing. So I'm just getting the joy of a well-crafted initial sentence. In some way that Picasso's, many of his paintings are very spontaneous. They're not, he doesn't go back and work them through. They're not like a Rembrandt or something like that. I'm just playing with the, what if your writing was just like right down, just really quite beautiful. It's not polished, but still has some sort of energy to it. So I'm practicing that, but I'm unfinished. All of this was, I was writing while I was thinking before I did this. I wrote one version, a long version, and then I wrote another version. And then and I'm kind of speak writing at the moment. And after this, I'm going to write down whatever the heck I just said is my way of kind of making sense of all this. Karen.
Thank you. And one of the things that we thought would be good to do is we've collectively put together some of the links to websites and books that we each have enjoyed and journal articles, so that that resource will be available on the eSocSci, Engaged Social Science website. So just to say that there's something more from the session. And it's great actually from my point of view just to hear each other. So I hope that this is proving useful and thought-provoking for you as well. And one of the things that was a powerful kind of moment for me was being at a writing course. Like, I sign up for every writing course that's going if I can fit it in. Was someone saying to treat your writing as urgent as your class that you have tomorrow. And while I don't always manage to do that, I try to sort of keep saying that this is as important as my teaching. And so I do map out in my diary my ideal plan, my cunning plan, and ensure it gets encroached upon at times. And even when that happens, I have started to sort of realise that there's, you know, great things are still possible in small amounts of time, like the 25 minutes, like rather than waiting for that kind of ideal stretch of time. Even though it doesn't, it would be easier to check my email and, you know, you think, oh, well, what can I do in 25 minutes? I'm pushing myself more and more, partly because I'm suggesting this as a strategy. I need to try it. And in fact, even just working on an argument or doing something with a, you know, a sentence or two, and then what seems to happen between times, or so I tell myself, is that my brain kind of continues to work on it between that sort of short writing stint between and the next one. And sometimes I even kind of might solve a writing dilemma while I'm walking from A to B. You know, just there's something that kind of happens, not always, but there's that kind of percolation that's going on that I think can be helpful between writing sessions. And I kind of keep thinking to myself, maybe this is a better use of 25 minutes than clearing my email. So work in progress. Now, I mean, the routine is obviously, I'm someone that kind of, you know, works well with routine. I know that doesn't work with for everybody, but, you know, punctuated with rewards, the morning coffee, the walk in the afternoon, those kind of things, and actually those mundane tasks of hanging out the washing that might just, again, have a break, a physical break from being at the computer, again, a thinking break that I think is really important. And another sort of part of cultivating myself as a writer is teaching and writing about writing, because it actually was, it felt like a risky step to head into that space, because if you say that you're writing, you know, writing about writing or teaching about writing, then your writing's up for more scrutiny. And so it does feel like a scary space to be in at times, and even boldly organising this panel and then including myself on it, that's how I got on it, was, you know, again, just pushing myself to take up that, you know, because I think every time we put it centre stage and kind of, you know, talk about how we make writing happen amongst ourselves, that actually we can make it, and how we make it enjoyable. I mean, yes, it's acknowledging the hard work, but how do we make it enjoyable? Because, you know, I think it'll make it more fun, but also kind of, you know, whether we're writing a PhD or writing for publication as part of our work expectations, our kind of futures depend on our capacity to write. So I'll stop there. Yeah. This is silent. I'll pass it back to the chairperson.
This is what, sorry?
Pass it back to you.
Okay. Thank you all for all those wisdoms and strategies that you all use. So we've got about another 10 minutes, I think, and so this is where chaos may reign, because we have time now for people to ask questions and make comments, and, you know, you're tiny little dots, most of you, that I can see on the screen, and actually many of you are not even dots that I can see because you are on your desktops, and I gather Melanie is able to, there is a thing, is there a way that people can indicate they want to
put their hands up
like electronically, yep, on their desk. So anyway, we're going to just go for it. So those of you who are actually in a room with a camera that we can probably see, maybe you want to start, and Melanie will then feed me anybody else who's sitting at their desktop that she's happened to, they've happened to communicate something. So anybody anywhere around the motu, put your hand up, maybe is the best way to.
We've got one here in Otago.
Great.
We're not moving the camera at the moment, so there we go.
Yeah.
Oh, there you go. Look at you. Fabulous.
Okay. Yeah.
Green.
So what do you all do when you hit a brick wall? What do you do in those moments of crisis when, you know, nothing is going right? What do you do?
When you hit a block? Is that the question?
Yeah. Okay. Sometimes I sleep. If I'm at a writing retreat and I've got this time open, I'll sleep, because that sometimes it's kind of soothing. But other times I'll revert back to other tactics. So I'll move away from the computer, I'll go to paper, I'll go to whiteboard, I'll go to markers, I'll go to pencil, I'll go to diagrams, I'll go away from the, get away from the screen, you know, the kind of the linear text. Sometimes I'll go walking with a friend. I'll say, I need to talk. Can we walk? The walking is actually, I've discovered walking and talking is actually very good for helping with the block.
Just building on what Barbara's saying, so I do exactly the same thing. There seems to be kind of at least two different kinds of blocks, and it's very hard to tell the difference between them. One is like there is really nothing and you need to walk away. Literally walk away, actually have a walk, do something else, get away from the task. But other times it's just, you just need to allow the writing to come out. So you need to go to a different medium. The felt tip pens are right on the whiteboard. I usually will take pen or paper and I'll just scrawl stuff down. And the writing's there, it just needed an avenue to come out where I wasn't being so finicky and picky about how good it is. You can't always tell the difference between what the block is. So usually my first one is usually just try writing it free writing. And I might try writing the same thing two or three different times to try to get my hand on it. If it's still blocked and it's all rubbish, then I'll go to plan B and I'll do something else. I'll go have a sleep, I'll go for a walk or something like that. We have this thing, I think, that we think we can write forever, and you can't. You can only write for a very short amount of time, and sometimes you've pushed it too much. And the best thing you can do is stop and come back to it another day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This book by Tristine Rayner, which is not about academic writing, has got some really good strategies for writing past blocks. It's an old book, but she acknowledges the presence of the internal critic, and she gives you ideas for how to engage with that internal critic in a way that keeps you moving in the way, in a sense, as Clinton is describing. So, the new diary. It's lovely, lovely book.
Karen, did you want to chip in anything on that, or is that?
No, that's fine. We'll go to the next question. We'll be good.
Okay. Now I gather Jordan King. Jordan, we can't see you anywhere, but you've got a question. Let's see if you can, if you unmute your microphone, you should be able to ask your question. Or I can read it from the screen.
Jordan said that the mic is broken. Yeah.
Oh, his mic is broken. Okay, so the question was it about recommendations for good books for writing?
Books about writing have engaged you to the point where you often refer back to them.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so the books that are so good that you know, they've become your kind of go-to places. Well, Barbara's already mentioned one. But have you got another one or two each you might recommend?
And that's part of the resource, actually. So that, you know, Jordan, if you, after this panel and tomorrow, the resource will be available on the eSocSci. And we've actually organised it by books that we've each enjoyed. So it's a compilation from the three of us. So that will give you some leads. Yeah. Unless any of you want to talk about specific books. Yeah.
No, actually, that's probably a good idea. Okay, so I see a question also from Massey Albany. Can you give some ideas for how you would move to editing for the reader? I know that leaving a piece for a while helps, but not always an option. Any other techniques?
I'll start with that one. I use a few techniques for that. One of them is once I've finished, I will do something else. Basically, if I've got a draft down, I will start another task of some sort, and I take as long as I can to help me forget whatever I meant. The danger is you only see what you meant rather than what's actually on the page, so you're just trying to distance yourself in some way. So putting it away for a while is good. You may not have time to do that. If you have limited time, I do something else in the meantime. But the other thing is just consciously putting myself in two different frames. I'm asking myself two different questions. At first, I'm only asking, what do I mean? And then I make sure I've answered that. Then I'm asking, what will the reader make of this? Or will the reader be able to make sense of this? And that's writing from a very different question. And so I'm doing something very, very different in that case. Physically, I have a tendency to blow up the stuff on the screen to 200 or 300% because you see it very differently. Or I'll read it out loud or something, so that I'm trying to hear it like a reader will hear it. Mm-hmm. So anything I can do that changes how this looks and how it appears to me seems to help.
Mm. I think related to that, I think printing it out so that you're not looking at it on a screen is a good idea, and then reading it away from your computer. So sometimes laying it out on the floor around you, page by page, and sort of sitting in the middle of it. Sometimes strategies like taking a highlighter pen and marking out the main idea in each paragraph. In other words, what you're doing when you do that is you're no longer writing, but you're thinking like a writer, thinking like a reader. Chopping up paragraphs into pieces and trying them out in different kinds of arrangements, and actually engaging, move away from the composing place that typically for us these days is the computer, and handle the main, make the manuscript into a different thing and handle it in different kinds of ways. I think those are some of the ways in which you can trick your psyche into slipping away from where it was when it wrote and into a slightly different, more critical kind of position. So take that hard copy, go to a cafe, take a highlighter, take a pencil, interact with it as if it's someone else's manuscript as much as you can. But you won't do that on the screen, I think, mostly.
I agree, and I think it's really good to kind of treat the composing and generating of text and editing as separate activities, and to really, you know, tell the editing sort of voice to shut up while you're kind of getting it down. I just think that sometimes it's worth going for it, even though, you know, it's not great stuff. This is what works for me, like, and then we're going back to work with it in the ways, you know, the different kinds of ways that you've talked about, especially for me, I really like interacting with hard copy as well.
One other thing I'll add is I find that as soon as I think I'm going to pass it to somebody else to read, my mind shifts. So I suddenly go, oh my God, this is much worse than I thought it was. So there really is a mind shift. Is if you're actually going to give it to somebody else, you suddenly look at it differently.
Yeah,
I noticed that with my PhD when, you know, I was going to my supervisors, doesn't matter so much. But as soon as I thought, actually, it's going to go to the examiners, I started looking at it very differently. So actually, intending to give it to someone else will change the way you look at it. And once you get it back from them, I find that just a couple of comments from them, I will immediately look at it completely differently. And even if it's only been a couple of days, just a minor lot of comments from somebody else helps me to shift in reading it like they've read it.
Great, thank you. I think we're going to run out of time before we run out of questions, but we have a question here in Auckland from one of the people in the room here. So, Barbara, do you want to say your question?
Yeah, my question is, since thinking is writing and writing is thinking, we often have a lot of ideas and we keep jumping from one idea to another. How do we bring coherence? Because since we are in PhDs, it's very difficult to bring coherent in your ideas and synthesize that, because we keep jumping. It is happening with me. One thought with the other, and then, you know, it's heyway. So how would you do that?
And I don't think you're alone, actually. You know, just hearing sort of the sort of sense around the room here, and like I think it is really tough to try and stay with the main focus. And sometimes, like one of the things that I keep saying now is working out what your main argument is for that moment in the piece of writing that you're working on, like whether that's the literature review, like it's, you know, what is your main argument about the literature review? What is your main argument about this piece of data analysis, or what's the main point that you're wanting to make at this, in this particular section of writing? And actually just getting really clear about that, and, you know, whatever else comes to mind, which might be really fruitful for something else, like try and, you know, maybe note it down if you want to, like put it to one side. And just have that argument, whether you sort of print it off and have it up the top of your screen, but just keep thinking, am I contributing to that? And maybe it ultimately gets changed, but that's one of the things that I think can be really helpful.
Anyone else got to add to that? Or we have one more question that I can see that we could just really quickly get to. Can I just go to the last question?
Mm-hmm. Please.
Yep. And this is from Leon. We won't even try to get Leon to talk. Sorry, Leon Salter. And he's asking about, he said, Barbara said that about reading, giving her voice, you know, by reading other people, helping kind of feed your writing. But for me, this can cloud my voice. I take the latest thing I've read and apply that rather than using my own voice. Any tips for bringing other voices in without losing your own distinct voice?
Yeah. I had actually just started to write a response to that, thinking we might run out of time. So I'll just, but I'll talk to that for a second. I think my own experience is that when I'm reading new ideas from other authors, kind of ideas that I sense might be powerful for my thinking and writing, the first kind of writing I produce is overlaid and it has too much of the other author's voice in it. Mm. But I've also come to realise that that is the way I come to grips with what it is that I think they're saying, is that I have to write in that sort of overladen with the other voice kind of way, and that I just need to understand that that is not the writing I'm going to be doing for a piece of work of my own. That's kind of like the writing I do is an intermediate stage between reading, coming to understand the ideas of another author, and then eventually being able to use them in my own writing in a way that is much more through my own understanding of their ideas, which is through my voice again. So I find that there is a whole kind of writing that I do when I'm grappling with new ideas, which is writing that does not make its way into manuscripts or publication. That's kind of, and that's been hard because it's often quite hard writing. And so you kind of want to use it for something, but its use value lies in coming to understand the ideas more deeply, which I don't get from talking or just thinking about them. Writing, as Clinton said, writing is thinking. So that's my response to that, Leon.
I just want to chuck something in. It's not really answering Leon's question, but it's building on what Barbara says. One of the things that makes me a good writer is my ability to throw away most of my writing. I became a much, much better writer when I got less precious about it and could throw away 75% to 90% of what I wrote. Its use was a step to get to good writing. I wasn't attached to it. You must have all had that. You write a good paragraph. Well, you write a good paragraph. It's not quite right, and you think, oh, I want to keep it. I spent so much time on it, etc. But it actually harms your work, and you're much better to throw it away. So throwing away writing seemed to be one of the greatest things to make me a better writer.
Mm.
So sorry, I wasn't answering the question, but I thought it was a useful one to chuck in.
They're groaning around the table. Oh no, throwing away our babies.
Yeah, killing our darlings.
Yeah. Okay, good note to finish on.
Go kill a few darlings.
Yeah, before we go, I realise we are out of time, but I just want to make a plug for people who haven't already joined this fabulous new network to do so. It's not very hard at all to sign up to eSocSci if you're not already a member, and then just go out to the network and go, bing, join. I did it this morning, and instantly you're a member. But then you'll be able to keep up with the new events as they come up. May 18, you might want to put in your diaries now, there's going to be a session on, I don't know, have the precise title, but something about writing for journals, some kind of seminar similar to this on that topic. So
hearing from editors, it's actually, we've got a panel of editors,
fantastic. So the people who make the decisions about whether you get in or not. So it's like going to God.
Yes.
All there is now to do is just to thank everybody for attending. I hope the technology has worked okay for the people that we can't see near and far. And absolutely, most importantly, to thank the three panellists for sharing all their many years of experience and their wisdom with us. So thank you.
And thanks, Avril.
Thank you, Avril. Yeah. And there'll be resources and there's a forum as well as part of the network. So follow up if you want to. Thank you.
Thanks, Karen.